Hi everyone, and welcome again to the online service of Three Rivers Church in Bedford. My name is Steve. If you don't know me, welcome. Thanks for joining us again this week. It's our first Sunday of the month, which means we're going to have some time together in communion later on. So now's the time to go and get the bread and the wine if you haven't got it ready for later on. And also we're going to have some testimonies as well, hearing about what God is doing in people's lives at this time. We're really looking forward to hearing from Josh later as well. He's going to be speaking a bit later this morning. There's no Zoom coffee at the end of the service this week. Some people are not around to host that, so that's not happening. But Flame is back on. I'm back from holidays, so guys, young people, Flame is back on right after the service if you want to join me for that. Also happening this week, we've got our usual prayer meeting on Monday on Zoom. All the details of that and everything else that's going on at the moment are in the news sheet. So please read that, because there's loads of things in there, and things that I won't mention are in there as well. Friday football is now at 6 o'clock, and that's on Friday. Anyone can join in with that at Russell Park at 6 p.m. on Friday. And then a week on Tuesday, we've got a day for the King. Once a month, we spend a day in prayer and fasting for the Lord. And that's going to be a week on Tuesday. Some of that on the evening will be in the building if you want. It'll also be on YouTube. Yep, so you can watch it there as well if you prefer. But if you want to join us in the building, then the details of how you can do that are in the news sheet. You need to email Meryl. And then we've got our AGM in a couple of Sundays' time as well. So just advance notice of that. Please join us for that if you can. Again, check the news sheet for details. But we've got some important stuff we need to tell you about. So join us for the AGM in a couple of weeks' time. Right. Let's stand if you're able. I'm going to read some scripture and then we're going to continue worshiping the Lord. And I want to read from Psalm 90. It says, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. So worshiping God this morning, he has been our dwelling place throughout all generations, not just this generation, but throughout all generations, God has been the dwelling place of his people, the place where we come to rest, the place where we come to be at home. So when we come into his presence this morning, we come home. And so, Lord, we ask you to move in us today, Lord. We say that you are our God and you are our place of rest. You are our home, Lord. And we come to you when we need rest. We come to you when we need to be in that place where we are home, where we can just be in your presence. And so we come this morning to that place and we want to worship you, Lord, and see you are our God. From generation to generation, you are our God. From everlasting to everlasting, before this world even existed, you were God. And you still are God, and we love you, Lord, and we worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, Three Rivers Church. It seems a long time, doesn't it, since we all met together as a church family. And I wanted to take this opportunity, really, just to say thank you to every one of you for supporting each other. And it's often those small acts of kindness and support that are really appreciated by other people. And we just want to encourage us all to keep going in that. And just to say that if any of you feel that you need support, maybe you'd like someone to call you, or there's other ways in which we as a church can support you, please just take the time to contact us at the office or text me. We don't want anybody to slip through the cracks. We want to be a supporting community to you. So please, if there's any pastoral needs or anything that we can do to help support you, just please let us know. Thanks.
this darkness lead me through until all I see is you, yeah. And God, I'm running for your heart, running for your heart till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways. I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. When I am a soul on fire. Lord, let me burn you again. Let me return to you again. Till I am so on fire, Lord, I'm longing for your ways, waiting for the day when I am so on fire. I'm running for your heart, a soul on fire, till I am so on fire, till I let me return to you again. Lord, let me burn, burn for you again. Let me return. Till I am so on fire, filthy with my sin, I come to you. With nothing left to bring, I cry out to you. From all these worthless things, I turn to you. And in my barrenness, I worship you. And I won't hide my face in the tears of my disgrace. Jesus, meet me, come, Lord, save me, wash me clean and make me holy. I was born to love you. Spirit, come, breathe life where there be.
Each week we come to you with some words of knowledge which we believe that God has given us for this particular moment in time. That there are people here today listening to this service who will be responding to these words. And they come from a group of people who've been praying during the week and asking God what he's saying for today. So I'm going to share them on behalf of everybody, and I'm going to take some time to pray for them at the end. So, somebody with a swollen ankle which is not healing. somebody else who's quite devastated because a close friend has let them down over something which they were really relying upon them for. Somebody who's experiencing nosebleeds, suffering with sleeplessness, or has a sore neck and shoulders. Others who have anxiety and fear for others, which is burdening you. Just the encouragement to cast your burdens onto Jesus. And then there's somebody who's struggling to come to a place of trust and is fearful of letting God come into a particular area of your life. That the Lord is saying to you, don't be afraid to open up all of your life and every situation to me, for I am a good, good father and I can be fully trusted. You are my child. You have been adopted into my family and I love you. Don't be afraid to open up all your heart to me, for my perfect love casts out your fear. Don't be afraid to open up your finances to me, for I am your loving provider. I have blessing for you, not cursing. I have provision for you, not poverty. I have hope for you in the place of hopelessness and despair. And I bring to life those things that have shriveled up and died. So give all your cares and anxieties and fears to me. Watch and as I take hold of the things you have given me and do far more for you than you could ever imagine. Oh, my child, trust me because I love you with an unfailing, unconditional love, and you are precious to me. So if you respond to any of those words, I would suggest that you just show that by reaching out, opening a hand, just receiving from God as the rest of us join in a prayer together. Father God, I thank you that you speak so specifically. I thank you that each of these words, you want to come and you want to minister to individuals this morning. We just invite you by the power of your Holy Spirit to come and bring healing, to come and bring trust, to come and bring change in situations. Father God, we give you all those things mentioned and ask that you will come, do what you need to do by the power of your Spirit. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Okay, my name is David. I've got a very brief testimony. A couple of weeks ago, I was down at Friday night football with Natalie. As all of you know, I love football, so it's kind of one of my favourite places to be, only because Natalie's playing. And at the end of the session, I started to feel as if my hand just there was throbbing a bit and itching a bit and kind of feeling a bit painful. Not extremely painful, just kind of irritating. I get that kind of thing quite a bit with allergics to you know what. And when I actually got home, I realised that it was bleeding. In fact, there's still a little spot there. It was bleeding from where that spot is, quite a big mark at the time. There you go. And I didn't think too much of it, and it was really itching right up until bedtime. Went to bed, woke up about 10 to 3, something like that, with a real throbbing pain on my hand. It really felt as if it was going to explode. So I took myself downstairs, so I didn't disturb anyone, and put the light on and noticed that it was actually bulging out like that, literally like that. It's all puffy and horrible. And where that spot is, there was a circle of blue and green marking, and thought, this isn't just an ordinary reaction, this is kind of some bite or sting. So I kind of put my hand over it and I said, Lord, you know how much I love football. Please don't inflict this pain on me as well. And I commanded it to go, and I literally just dropped off to sleep in the chair. In fact, just where I am now. So I dropped off to sleep and woke up probably about half an hour later. All the pain had gone and it was almost back to normal. And the mark was literally what there is now. and it can only have been God's healing at work. It's just fantastic. Praise God.
Almost a year ago, I suffered a displaced disc in my neck, which meant that the disc was pressing against the spinal cord. This was a serious injury, and I ended up in Addenbrooke's Hospital, where surgery took place to free the spinal cord. I spent 4 weeks altogether in Addenbrooke's and had a small amount of physio whilst I was there. The surgeon said that the surgery would stop any further decrease in my abilities, but he didn't think there would be too much improvement in what I had. However, when I went back to the hospital, I saw somebody there who was very surprised at the progress. And when I had a consultation by telephone with the surgeon, he again was surprised at the amount of progress I had made with my walking and with the use of my hand, because my right side had been totally affected by the injury. From Addenbrooke's, I was discharged to Bedford Hospital, and there I received further intensive physio, which enabled me to get walking with assistance of frames, and also to be able to get up and down stairs, so that after 4 weeks in Bedford Hospital, I was able to be discharged. During my time in hospital, I was visited by Paul and David, and they brought me words of scripture and also brought me a handkerchief anointed with anointing oil for healing, which I greatly appreciated. Paul also prayed that I would have accelerated healing, and that has really been part of what I have experienced over this last year. Slow progress it may appear, but even the hospital authorities have acknowledged how fast this improvement has taken place. The last one who saw me was surgeon from the spinal injuries unit in Soap Mandeville, and he was very surprised at the mobility that I had recovered over this last year. And I was able to witness, not only to him but to the staff in Addenbrooke's and Bedford Hospital, that it was the result of people praying that had brought about this increased healing in my body. When I was discharged home, I had physios come in and work on me in the home, and they got me walking even better. And with a travelator, I am now able to walk over a mile without stopping. And recently as well, I've been able to get back driving, not great distances at the moment because I haven't driven for 11 months, but short distances around town have been really good and freeing for both Jill and myself. I'd like to thank everyone who'd been praying for me, but most of all, I'd like to thank God for the healing that has taken place in my body over this last 12 months. And I ask God, as he has blessed me, to bless each and every one of you.
Hi folks, Phil and Jenny, of course, and here we are together in Bedford. And by time you actually see this on Sunday morning, we'll still be together, but we'll actually be in the car going down the M1, M25 to Heathrow, where I will be boarding a plane at 2:20 this afternoon and on my way again to Bangladesh. We're very grateful to the church and to God's goodness to us over these past months, both since we came back from Bangladesh in March, but also particularly over the last two or three months when it's been quite an unstable situation for a while in our family.
Yes, at the end of July, we were on holiday with our two families. And as we prayed together that last night, there was that definite sense of uncertainty waiting on God for each of us. Andy, pilot with BA, waiting news, but he has still a job with BA. He's been transferred over to Heathrow instead. And Tim and family back because of COVID from Tanzania, they're expecting their fourth child now, with the twins just turned three. And the question mark was, would Tim have to go back to Tanzania alone? And the result is that he can stay and work in the UK for Tanzania until January when the baby is born. So we are very thankful for both of those situations being clarified in a positive way.
And for us, end of July, we went through a process with talking with church leaders and the trustees of our Bangladesh Partnership Trust, and with putting certain precautions and documents in place, there came out an agreement that, yeah, it was good and right for me, at least, to return to Bangladesh. That was going to be end of August, but the group that works on our behalf in getting visas in Bangladesh has hit some major problems in their government relationships, and everything through them at the moment is on hold. So now we're going an alternative route, which is a short-term visa, and I have a two-month visa just to get me back there, see how things are going, sort out a few things, meet with folks, bit of encouragement, bit of teaching, bit of encouraging, as I said. So certainly appreciate your prayers for that. I go, say, this Sunday, today, as you're watching this, and come back, God willing, COVID-free, at the beginning of December, ready to come out of quarantine in time for Christmas. So we do appreciate your prayers for that. God's will might be done in us and through us, and that he might be glorified, and that the church in some small way might be encouraged or benefited in some small way by me being there. And Jenny, staying here in the UK this time around.
Yes, and popping over to Saffron Walden to give a hand there, even possibly to Andy's family.
And then being around when the next grandchild is born.
Yes.
So great. See you soon, guys. Thanks for your prayers. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Good morning, Three Rivers. For those of you that don't know, my name is Josh. I am married to Amy. I've got a son named Louis, and I support Manchester United. And I've been living in Bedford just over 3.5 years now, and recently taken a job with the church as a trainee evangelist. Over the last few weeks, I've been umming and ahhing as what to speak on today. And it kind of came in a way that I didn't expect, really. At 9 o'clock, I should say 9 o'clock, it's probably more like 8 o'clock, on a Monday morning, there was banging going on in my at my flat. And it was very, very strange, but it was a way that the Holy Spirit was trying to get my attention. And I thought, what is God trying to say here with all this banging? It was quite annoying. But realized that God was trying to speak to me about reconstruction, buildings, and foundations. So that's where I feel I want to speak on this morning to you. This also then led me to a story which is found in the Bible, found in Matthew chapter 7, which is probably one of the best sermons that you will find going. It talks about all kinds of things, giving to the poor, the seriousness of committing adultery. It's got the Lord's Prayer, all kinds of different things. But I want to get right to the end of this passage at Matthew 7 about the wise and foolish builders. And I'm reading from NIV. So, Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 29. If you turn with me, that would be great. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. Let's pray before we look into God's word. Father, I just thank you that you are here. I thank you that you are good. I thank you that you are Lord. Lord, I just pray that you would speak to every individual tuning into this service live or later on. Lord, I just pray that you would touch hearts. Lord, I pray our hearts would be open today. Lord, I pray my heart would be opened. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would be poured out in a fresh way, Lord, on me this morning. Lord, I pray your power would just touch people, Lord. We pray for your word and your spirit to come together today and to touch people's lives, that they'd be transformed. Lord, we want people's houses to be on the rock, Lord. I just pray for those, Lord, who feel like their lives maybe are on the sand this morning, God, that you would touch their lives here today by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. As this morning we're looking at houses and foundations, what I don't joke on construction. The only problem is I'm still working on it. On a serious note, the question I want you to ask yourselves this morning is, how is your house doing? Just think about that for a moment. I'm not talking about a mansion or a detached kind of house or a semi-detached kind of house. I'm asking about your life, your faith, your heart. What does that look like? Does it look good on the outside? Maybe you've got lots of money. Maybe you're doing well in your job, or maybe you go to church once a week. These houses that Jesus speak about in this story could have both looked very similar on the outside. However, the main difference was that one was built on a firm foundation, something that was stable and secure, and the other wasn't. It was built on something that wasn't. Building our lives on the rock is not easy, and it takes time for the construction work to be done. But Jesus is the rock. He helps us in those times of pain and difficulty and the storms of life that come. Back in March, my sister had a terrible thing happen to herself. She lost both of her legs. Such a difficult time for our family. But we knew God in the storm. Before God transformed my life, I was living my life on the sand. My house was full of brokenness. I turned to alcohol, to drugs, to all kinds of different things which were damaging me and killing my life. My life was an utter mess. Bad things happen to people in life, but where do you turn? We all have a choice. Some of you right now, your house is shaking. Perhaps some of you are sitting there angry at God right now. Others of you perhaps frustrated as you've not got the answers you wanted. Maybe some of you have so many questions about COVID and where is God in all of that. Maybe some of you are in debt or going through a relationship breakup. Maybe you've been abused or you've not found the healing that you're looking for. I'm encouraging this morning to turn your eyes to Jesus. You might know that song, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Some of us know this morning that there are things in our lives that if people saw really what was going on, we'd feel rejected or abandoned. I want to tell you that Jesus promises never to leave us or forsake us. God isn't looking for polished people who have it all together, who don't seek any help. He wants people who are in need of a savior. C.S. Lewis says these words. Imagine yourself as a living house. God comes in to rebuild that house. At first, perhaps, you can understand what he's doing. He's getting the drains right and stopping the leaks in the roof and so on. You knew that those jobs needed doing, and so you are not surprised. But presently, he starts knocking the house away, about in a way that hurts abominably and does not seem to make any sense. What on earth is he up to? The explanation is that he is building quite a different house from the one you thought of. Throwing out a new wing here, putting on an extra floor there, running up towers, making courtyards. You thought you were being made into a decent little cottage. But he is building a palace. He intends to come and live in it himself. Some of us have perhaps allowed clutter to fill our homes, our lives with things that are sinful. Well, I believe God is saying it's time for a clear out. You know, I know that for myself and my life. There's times every day I need a clear out. I need the things to be cleared out of my life that prevent me from having an intimate relationship with God. You know, some of those things for you might be selfishness, greed, jealousy, pride, control, anger, violence, hatred, gossip. Such a killer. I hear it so much these days, gossip. People talk about other people and you have a perspective of someone before you've even met them. Sexual immorality. Some of you know what you get up to behind closed doors when no one's about. But it's time to go. God is saying it's time for that stuff to go today. You've got to leave that stuff today. You know, the fruit of the Spirit, it talks in Galatians 5 about the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. God is looking for people who surrender their lives to him. You know, personal holiness is so key to all of this. We need to take time to build spiritual disciplines in our lives. You might have heard of them. Prayer, fasting, gratitude, confession, all that kind of stuff. You know, we really need to be building our lives on this stuff. It's so important. I guess the question is, do we want to be really serious about God? Do we want to run away from sin, from living lives that we control? He wants his church to rise up, to be different. We've got to be different to this world. You know, it says in Revelation about not being lukewarm because he'll spit you out of his mouth. You know, you're either hot or you're cold. You can't be lukewarm. That's my challenge to you today. Where's your foundation? Are you on a rock? Is your house, are you going to be a wise man with your house on the rock? Or are you just going to continue to build your house on the sand? Don't be lukewarm. You know, either be in or out. You know, God says, it says in his word that we're supposed to be in the world, but not of it. You know, so many of us just love flirting with sin. We just love it. You know, God is saying to us today that he's got to be a lifestyle. Jesus has to be a lifestyle. He's not a snack. You know, he's not just a choice off the buffet. You just take what you want. You've got to be full out for him today. You know, yesterday, I came home and the front door was knocked down of the flat below. But I believe that this is a prophetic picture for many of us today. I believe God wants to knock down our doors today. He wants to knock down your front door. He's saying, will you let me in? Will you let me into all those things in your life? All those things that no one knows about. All those things, all those struggles, all those sin. All those sinful things. You're going to let him transform your life by the power of his Holy Spirit. Father, just pray right now that you just touch people, that you'd reveal things by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray your light would just shine right now on things in people's lives which are hidden in darkness. And Lord, I just pray for guilt, shame, and condemnation to all leave right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray they just know a sense of your love. Lord, reveal your love to people in a new way today. Crazy thing is, when there was construction work being done on the house below, I talked about at the beginning, you know, Amy and I thought we might have got away from that, and we went on holiday last week, but the funny thing is, there was construction work being done on the house above as well. So, you know, God is always looking for us, he's always finding us, and he always wants to do work on us, but some of us, I know, God's been knocking on that door, and we've kind of ignored him. And I don't want to say this in a way of guilt or condemnation for you today, but I just want you to know that I'm saying these words because I care for you and because Jesus cares for you too. And actually, he wants you to live in more freedom. You know, I want more freedom. You know, God's freed me from so many things, but I know there's many things in my life. I want to be free, you know. I want to be different. I want to live like Jesus. Perhaps you're watching this today. You don't know Jesus. But I want to say to you, he's knocking on the door of your heart. He's saying to you, will you let him in? You know, he died for you. He died for me. For all the wrong things that we've done. He took all the sin, all this stuff I've been talking about today, greed, sexual immorality, all that kind of stuff. It's called sin. He took all that stuff and he paid it, paid the price by his blood. You know, we're going into communion in a short while, but you know, the blood of Jesus is so powerful. The blood of Jesus is what frees us. It's freedom. The blood brings freedom. Just acknowledge that Jesus is Lord, that he died for you for all the wrong things that you've done, and say, Lord, I want to turn to you. I want to open up my heart to you today. I repent for all the things I've done. You know, I've failed and fallen short so many times. Every day I fall short. Every day. But my need for Jesus is even greater. My need for Jesus is even greater. He needs to be a priority in my life. You know, when I gave my life back to him, I was hot. So on hot for the Lord. I'll be honest, I've fallen a bit lukewarm. But I need the fire of the Spirit, man. We need the Holy Spirit because he is all that we need and he changes our life. So just like the wise man, I'm asking you today, will you build your house on the rock? Will you build your foundation on Jesus? Will you let Jesus take every part of your life? I'm not talking about half of your house, half of your heart. Will you give yourself fully to him this morning? As we close this part of the service, I guess the four things that I'd say to you this morning are four H's. I know preachers love using the same letter to explain things, so I thought I might be one of those guys today. The first one is, take this away. Be honest. You know, be honest about your situation, about the stuff that's going on in your life. Find people, friends that you can be accountable with, that you can talk this stuff through with. Some of those struggles, some of those things that go on behind closed doors. Maybe, you know, some of this stuff that's actually happened to you, you know, some of this difficult things. Be honest. The second thing, get healing. You know, I mentioned the word abuse earlier. That's not a light word. You know, some of you might need some healing. And that might take time. But that's okay. God wants to bring healing to your life today. Physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, let the healer set you free. The third thing, live holy. You know, we have a choice. We can't live in the light and the dark. But you know, for us as people, we need to be people who live holy lives that are different to people, the world. We've got to be different. You know, we talk about the word revival. We talk about all these kind of things, sometimes a bit casually for my own liking. And I love the name revival. I'd love to see revival happen. But I believe God is saying to his church, clean up. Clean up your lives. Clean up your lives to me. And be fully, fully in love with me. And I'm talking about, you know, sometimes I think not just turning up for a Sunday service and, you know, expecting after an hour to get home for your roast chicken, you know. Those days are gone. We've got to be serious about God. We've got to be serious about him. You know, I don't know what you get up to behind closed doors. I know that the things that I get up to behind closed doors, sometimes not great. I waste a lot of time. But this is a challenge and encouragement for you today. Live a holy life. Give your whole heart, wholeheartedly to him today. Don't hold back. And the fourth thing I would say to you today is have hope. Have hope. It doesn't matter what the past looks like. It doesn't matter what's happened. It's about now. It's about having hope now. Have your hope in Jesus. Put all your trust in Jesus, because I tell you, he will never, ever let you down. So let's pray. Father, I just thank you for this day. I thank you, Lord, that you are touching my brothers and sisters. Right now, why don't you just put your hands in front of you, actually, as a sign to say, God, I'm surrendering myself before you today. God, I just pray for every single person who needs to be honest, Lord, needs to be honest with their family, their friends, even themselves and with you, Lord. That's the most important thing, Lord, is being honest with you. Lord, I pray for those who need healing today. God, I just pray that you would bring healing right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I pray you just bring healing by the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, I just also pray for those that want to live holy lives, but so much stuff gets in the way, so much distraction, so many worldly possessions just seem so much more tempting. Father, I just pray for children who would be on fire for you, who would live their lives just wholeheartedly for you, God. And Lord, as I said, Lord, I just pray for those of us this morning, actually all of us this morning, not those of us. I pray all of us would have hope in you. All of us would have hope in you, Jesus, because you're the best thing. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys. Be blessed.
Well, good morning, everyone. We're coming to a time in our service when we remember the death of the Lord Jesus for us in communion. But just before we take communion, we're going to pray particularly for Phil and Jenny Bushell, because Phil is due to be travelling today back to Dhaka in Bangladesh, going to be there for about 2 months of ministry while Jenny remains here. And it'd be good for us to pray for Phil as he travels. He's going to have a couple of weeks of quarantine when he gets there. He will be in contact with folks there during that time, but then he'll be free to travel and free to connect with people there. So let's pray for him and pray for Jenny as we start this communion time. Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord, that you are Lord of all the earth, and there's no place in which you are not there and you're not ruling. And we want to especially commit Phil to you as he travels today off to Bangladesh. We pray for a safe travel. We ask, Lord, for a good entry with all the complexities of visas and everything else, Lord, there will be no difficulty and he'll be able to get into Dhaka. And we pray for your hand upon him during those couple of weeks of quarantine, that he'll be able to still be in touch with folk, have a really good communication with Bengali brothers and sisters. And then we pray for your enabling and equipping for him during that time, that you will use his ministry powerfully and effectively in that time. It'd be a great encouragement to those he's ministering to. Give him words when he's teaching and preaching, Lord, may he be a great encourager. And we also ask, Lord, that you would be with Jenny as she remains back here, in a sense, holding the fort, but also providing that communication link for Phil back here. Lord, bless them, we pray. Watch over them. Use them mightily. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we're coming now to communion, and we're going to remember Jesus and what he has done for us. And I'm going to read some verses from Scripture, first of all, from the first letter of John and chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. This is what John writes. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we've seen it and testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. You know, the New Testament writers are very clear about what they'd seen and heard. They saw Jesus, they saw the Messiah, they saw the Son of God come in the flesh, and they saw him as clearly as you and I see the bread and the cup before us. They touched him. Jesus wasn't a figment of their imagination. He wasn't some kind of apparition, but he was flesh and blood. And they heard him. They heard him preach the crowds. They heard him talk to them individually. They heard him say those words, "This is my body, which is for you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." It's not just John who writes that way. Peter writes in his second letter. He says, "We didn't follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty." We were eyewitnesses. We saw, we heard, we touched. And I find that the communion celebration really is a reminder to me that Jesus really came. He really died. He really rose again. I think it's wonderful that Jesus has given us this kind of visible and tangible reminder of himself, reminding us that he also was visible and tangible. Just as we see and touch the bread and the cup, so he was seen and touched. And it's not a made-up story. It really happened. And the salvation that he has won for us is as real as these elements. So as we partake of the bread and the cup, let's thank the Lord that he came for us. Luke chapter 22, read this. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, I've eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And then he took bread. And he gave thanks. And he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, this is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So let's eat. Same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Let's drink with real assurance. Jesus died for me. He died for us. Thank you, Lord. Let's give thanks to the Lord for his goodness. Thank you, Lord, that we don't follow some cleverly devised story, but we follow the one who truly came for us. Thank you, Lord, you came, flesh and blood. You gave your flesh. You gave your body for us. You shed your blood for us. But Lord, we thank you also. It hasn't ended there, that you are risen and that you are here with us. And as we've celebrated, Lord, your coming for us and your dying for us, we celebrate also today your rising for us and the fact that you are here. We bless you, we praise you, we thank you for your grace given to us. And we ask, Lord, that you would give us that assurance day after day that you are the living God, the real God, who is with us day by day. We praise you and we thank you. Bless you, Lord. Amen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What can separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Wonderful name it is, the name.
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory.
See you. your speed.